episode of Progress, Potential, and Possibilities, discussions with fascinating people designing a better tomorrow for all of us. I'm your host, Ira Pastor.
Welcome, everybody, once again to another episode of our show, bringing you another really fascinating guest today, helping to create a better tomorrow for all of us. We have the honor today of being joined by Dr. Antonio Giordano, who is president and founder of the Sparrow Health Research Organization, which conducts a range of research to diagnose, treat, and cure cancer, but also has diversified in recent years into research in cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and a range of other chronic illnesses. Dr. Giordano is also a professor of molecular biology at Temple University here in Philadelphia, Chiara Fema, professor in the Department of Pathology and Oncology, University of Siena, and director of the Sparrow Institute for Cancer Research and Molecular Medicine and the Center for Biotech at Temple's College of Science and Technology. In his research throughout the years, Dr. Giordano has identified numerous cancer-related genes, including various tumor suppressor genes like RB2P130, which has been found to be active in lung, brain, breast, endometrial cancers, variety of other cancers, as well as some very interesting synergistic effects of gamma radiation in combination with this gene, ultimately accelerating the death of tumor cells. Dr. Giordano has also discovered cyclin A, CDK9, which is known to play important roles also in HIV transcription, as well as tumors and cell differentiation, CDK10. And he's also developed a range of patented technologies for diagnosing cancer along these lines. Dr. Giordano has published over 400 papers on a range of topics, including gene therapy, cell cycle, genetics of cancer, and epidemiology. In 2011, his team uncovered various anti-tumor agents that may be effective in treating of mesothelioma, a deadly cancer caused by prolonged asbestos exposure via ultimately inducing cell death without harming healthy cells. And Dr. Giordano has also been involved in many other fascinating programs, including a very interesting digital health program to see if computer animated avatars can assist people in losing weight, as well as interestingly analyzing the environmental relationship between the toxic dumping that was occurring in Italy by the Camorra and the Neapolitan Mafia and the illegal disposition of toxic waste. He's a fascinating guy. I'm glad to have him finally on the show. But Dr. Antonio Giordano, thanks for taking the time out of your schedule to come talk to us.
It's my pleasure, Ira. Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you very much for this great presentation. Really listing a little bit all the interesting things that happen in my life, and then a lot of these things also thanks to the outstanding people, student, postdoc, and individual that I had around me during this long journey in this country.
Yeah, it's been a fascinating journey. As you and I know, we've been friends for a little bit. We talked over the years. I'd like to hand you the floor, though, just for a little bit to take us a little further into that journey. If you maybe talk for a couple of minutes about your background, from everything from where you grew up to when you first got interested in oncology. And then sort of the second part of that, obviously, here I am, an American, and there's an American listening to the show, but we know the name Sparrow, obviously, from the malls and the airports and so forth, and making delicious pizza and pasta. But talk a little bit about your relationship with Mario Sparrow and sort of the creation of the Sparrow Health Research Organization. I think those are two very important stories that are going to lay the basis of this.
This happened like almost 2 years, 30 years ago, when after my medical degree, I was fortunate enough to join Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory, whose director was James Watson. Also, they discovered the double helix along with Francis Crick, with Maurice Wilkins. Less people talk about Maurice Wilkins, and less people talk about Rosalind Franklin also, yeah, that unfortunately died. But I was trained as a medical doctor, as a pathologist, being my father an oncologist, a pathologist. So there was a major influence in my family, and a little bit a challenge to get away from an influential family to a country that clearly is number one in the field of biomedicine. And for me, having the opportunity to work with the most important people in the field of genetics, and there were few places where really genetics was happening, so the real action, and Cold Spring Harbor was one of that. And therefore, I learned two things. One, how was important to be in the right place with the right technology and in an exciting time. That you mentioned that my medical background plus the technology led me to really discover cyclin A CDK. And that was the first physical link between cell cycle cancer. Today, there are many drugs that are used in clinics. That discovery in 88, 89 was the first link of two fields that were completely unrelated. Okay, talking about cancer, talking about cyclin and CDK that were mostly studied in yeast or in a different species. So, meanwhile, being an Italian and coming from a different country was always difficult, okay, for it was challenging to not only to be in a competing area like cancer research, but also in the ability to raise money, raise funding. Sure. And I remember that one of the things really was obsessing me a little bit and all the people around, how we are able to do research, we have to raise money. At the time, there were not much NIH money, so you have to be able to write grants and do this. So there was a lot of situation that were leading to discourage me to remain in the field. But on the other side, I was observing this special figure of James Watson. Mm-hmm. James Watson was really an idol because he made a discovery that was important. But analyzing the discovery, analyzing other ability that he was able to generate. Watson was able to create around that small molecule DNA, creating whatever today is the modern field of genetics, okay, of the molecular biology, genetics. So, and he was clearly able to understand the value, okay, of that discovery. Because sometimes you make a discovery, but you are able to understand later on if this discovery can have an impact. And a few words really remind me how really important was that. The fact that at the time they understood from a simple model that that molecule could have biological impact. Mm-hmm. That was the major discovery, more than the structure. And Watson had another characteristic that had an impact on my growth. He was a genius, mm-hmm. really a genius in fundraising. He was able to generate and raise money from everywhere, from everyone. Mm-hmm. And he was able to communicate the importance of a basic research. And I realized at the time that in addition to be a great scientist, I really had to acquire that characteristics of fundraiser or the ability to fund myself. And since people were discouraging me, I mean, you are Italian, you the language, this and that, I mean, NIH grants is difficult. I said, well, in addition to NIH grants, that by the way, I got it most of the first, sure. first time that I applied, okay, for the grant, I understood also that I should have been more creative in raising money. And what I did, it is something very simple. Since most Italian, successful Italian were not involved in philanthropy, in the field of research, but were involved in some other things, about food, about other type of tradition, I start to hustle, let's put this way, some of the most successful Italian in the area. And one of them was Mario Sbarro. And Mario Sbarro, I met Mario Sbarro. And when I met Mario Sbarro, I told him what was my dream. And he believed me, probably because he was originally came also from Naples. Mm-hmm. And he gave me, when I was 28 years old, he gave me the first $1 million to create my own organization. And then when I started my first laboratory at Temple University, by the way, accept me there because it's very difficult for a young scientist at the beginning of their career, right after a postdoc working with a millionaire and having so much independence. But sure. between Mario Sbarro, funding that I was able to get through my work, back then I discovered RB2, cyclin A, CDK9, CDK10. And for me, it was important to demonstrate that even though as an independent scientist, even though from an institution that was not in a top league like Costa Garbo or Harvard, but in reality was a solid organization, the creative mind behind the first discovery was not due by a fortuitous presence in a competitive place, but I was able to compete and clone this gene and making that observation valid, even if it was not in that top place. That was really the beginning of my story in this country.
It's a fascinating journey, and I think even in 2021 where we are now, people have to do more than just, as you said, write their grants. You have to get creative. It's a different world out there. I take my hat off to you that aside from juggling everything at the institute, you have to serve this role, as most scientists don't know that role usually. So it just adds another important piece to everything you've done. So it's very impressive. Before we're talking a little bit, Antonio, and obviously I spent most of my career in the pharmaceutical industry, and if this was 20 years ago when you and I were looking at a top 10 list of drugs, we would see the names like Lipitor and Viagra and Celebrex. Not a lot of cancer drugs on there. But nowadays, we go to the top 10 list, and what do we see? We see a lot of drugs based on the work that groups like you have been doing. So Keytruda and Opdivo, PD-1 pathway, Imbruvica, BTK signaling, Avastin and angiogenesis. The list goes on.
Cyclin-dependent kinases, inhibitors of the cell cycle.
Exactly. And here we are, top 10 drugs 2021, mainly they're these cancer drugs. At SHRO, you have, basically created a very broad research program, looking one, obviously, at the genetics, which is where you've specialized over the years, but also two other very important topics that have come to the fore: epigenetics, which we've touched on some previous shows, and then microenvironment. Talk a little bit, as sort of time's gone on and you've developed the programs at SHRO, how sort of the interplay between these three important components of oncogenesis and the disease itself has sort of crafted and sort of modified how you've approached your own work at the Institute.
Yeah, way of a lateral thinking, okay? In reality, I was able to do this work because of my independence. And I was able to do this work because I was not influenced only by the single application of the grant. Even though I'm at Temple University, the Sbarro Health Research Organization is an independent organization that allowed many young scientists from Italy, but even other parts of the world, to work in an independent way, and in a certain way, to have the opportunity to work on different area of cancer research. Mm-hmm. So why I developed other things, remaining focused on what is mm-hmm. the molecular basis, the molecular function, because sure. cancer is a heterogeneous disease, but the heterogeneity of cancer is reflected also at the molecular level. And the molecule involving cancer are involved in many other dreadful diseases, mm-hmm. diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and even disease that apparently are rare. Then that's due by influence of my father. My father was a pathologist, was the first to demonstrate, for instance, UV lights cause skin cancer. Mm-hmm. He published in early 60s. And he was among the first to understand how carcinogen can interact with the DNA molecule. He can transform that as a teratogenesis. Mm-hmm. And since I have a medical background, I never forgot the fact that no disease can be considered rare or common. Depends from the side of the world that you live. A disease that can be common in Philadelphia can be rare in Naples, mm-hmm. or common in China, or can be rare in Germany. Mm-hmm. Just making some example. That what does it mean? That the environmental quality of a particular, and the habits of a particular country, and the technological progress really has an effect on human health. In addition, you have also the health lifestyle that change, okay? Because unfortunately, we got benefit by the fantastic development of many important technology, but not always human beings were able to control the technology, having a major impact on human health. We live longer, but also because we have better strategic tools in our hand for diagnose and cure many type of cancer. So the impact of human cells and how microenvironment, okay, mm-hmm. Of cell, but of any type of environment, micro and macro environment, if we can talk about this, have an origin, but you have to end up always to understand the mechanism. And that's why the precision medicine and the personalized medicine is important. Precision medicine and personal medicine is important because we need not only to know how our genes work, mm-hmm. and how they interact with each other, how the complexity of this network of molecule are able to function in a human cell in our body, but how also the environmental impact can affect this. That's, you have epigenetics. Yep. So you know that you can have a gene that in the same type of cancer in the two different patients can behave in a certain in a way, and another type of patient behave in a different way. A patient respond to a therapy, another patient does not respond to a therapy, respond in a more in a weaker way. And that depends because the gene can have multiple way to be inactivated, and not only there is the complexity, not a single gene, but the chaotic network in which us as a molecular biologist and the scientists, we try to put an order and an organization. And that's how we are aiming to. And in order to do that, my organization, the way that I created my organization, allow me also to spread on different area. Okay, mm-hmm. So the use of virtual reality, for instance, you mentioned that, how we use virtual reality. Now, virtual reality, we were the first to use virtual reality when it was Second Life training scientists in a laboratory. The first virtual laboratory, as CNN reported, that was in 19... in 2007. I remember CNN report that after 8-9 months, even Harvard University created the first virtual lab. But the Sbarro Health Research Organization did that much earlier. Okay, so. But also we were the first to use the virtual reality, then develop that and apply in medicine. Now virtual reality is becoming something very important, how to influence the mind. I know that of your interest is also the neurotherapy, for instance. Sure. Neurotherapy, that is an approach for issue like anxiety, depression, brain fog, fatigue, that can change the brain status. And this really, Ira, is an important topic that, thank you actually to mention that earlier, that because the neurotherapy and how the mind works is really the pandemia of the of this century. Yep. The most, the one of the most common diseases that will affect the human being were the psychiatric status of each one of us. And the COVID-19, this is one of the results also, the COVID-19 drama, okay, that happened to us, that created a lot of negativity in young people that were locked in the house and they were unable to interact, and but also create a lot of positive things, okay? So made understand how no longer the physical presence is necessary to carry on a certain type of task. And also will be something what for many years we were calling telemedicine, but that is something that we can now we can say that this finally can be developed and can be applied to human health, because everything we do, Ira, has to have a final goal to improve the quality of our health, our life, our longevity.
And you know, as you're mentioning the neurotherapeutic side of things, which you know you've diversified obviously into some of these other therapeutic areas. And you know, one of the interesting things that I noticed in the program where was this developmental biology component, where you're working with organisms like zebrafish and looking at neurogenesis, which is a fascinating area of my own personal interest. But talk a little bit about if you can, obviously nothing confidential, but the things you're looking at specifically in sort of the zebrafish work, nociception, wind signaling, which is, all fascinating development work. And then just as a side note, I don't know if this is related in any way, but as you know, I talked with our joint friend, John Chernoff over at Fox Chase a couple months ago. And we were brought up the sort of the, some of the historic work that happened here in Philadelphia of Beatrice Mintz. And sort of this work from the 1970s on how developmental biology and cancer have some a very interesting connection as well, a historic connection here in Philadelphia. Are you doing anything interesting there? I was just wondering.
I think that was very important. Just I want to tell this, that talking about neurotherapy, just I want to tell add one more thing.
Sure.
The traumatic brain injury, for instance, or the toxic insult, whatever heavy metal or toxicity can do to the brain. And that's what happened to the Twins Tower. When the Twins Tower, there is a neurotoxicity in a lot of kids, okay, that lived in the area or born, okay, during that period of time. But going back on the on developmental biology, that's something really that fascinates me as a scientist, physician, and work as a pathologist, because thanks to the work done in frogs, thanks to the work in done in sea urchin, for instance, thanks to the work done in a very simple organism, and then like zebrafish, the major discovery in medicine really happened, because in this model system, not only is an elegant, simple, and cheap way, let's put it this way, to carry on experiment, but will allow you to really to test really what is happening, what could happen in the real life. It is amazing how for instance, cyclin, and other genes, Wnt or other genes, were discovered in different species, could now be special targets for disease treatment in many areas. Yep. So I decided to hire, because Philadelphia, as you know, did many things happen in Philadelphia. I thought the first time I came to Philadelphia was just a PR. Oh, the first bank was here, the first university, the first hospital was here. Well, some of the first and most important discovery happened also in Philadelphia.
Yep.
And even the developmental biology program. And I remember that it was one of the latest was Eric Weinberg, if I remember well, it was in Pennsylvania, that he retired because he was not funded anymore. Okay, well, yeah, but he and I hired Dr. Gianfranco Bellipani was his last postdoc, and I set up this developmental biology program here, and I did this to test the efficacy of specific and selective molecules that could challenge important growth regulatory genes.
Yep.
So it is incredible how many information this simple model and innocent model could give us, and how much reproducibility then later on we are watching happening even when we transfer everything to human being. Mm-hmm. So that's why more and more some of these developmental biology model, and you mentioned zebrafish, but there are others important that will be really key. Yep. In order to speed some or increasing the translational component from the bench side to the bedside. Mm-hmm. And just in the last few years in our laboratory, using this cell model system, we identify a series of new molecules, a new generation of molecules that are potent molecule mimicking whatever some important tumor suppressor genes do naturally into the cell. Mm-hmm. So basically, we are able to replace a missing function because of due by epigenetic factor or other environmental factor or lifestyle. So we are able to replace some of this function, generating this molecule that can be easily and with high efficacy be delivered in the human body.
Yeah. And so as you know, one of my passions is sort of within this space has always been natural products. I worked in the natural product space for about a decade, sort of in the middle of my career. And you know, it's very interesting that amongst SHRO's interest in diagnosing, treating, and curing disease, when I go through those 400 plus papers of yours, things like studies on olive leaf extract and orange lemon extract, and of course, tomatoes pop out, an important preventative phytochemicals, things of this nature. Are you doing a lot nowadays with natural products anymore? Because obviously natural products has served as the basis the last century or so for a lot of chemotherapy drugs. Anything interesting on the natural products front that you're working on?
That's an area that interested me a lot, because reading newspaper or listening or watching TV, there's always a Mediterranean diet. Not because I am Italian, the study was done by Harvard, so independent, but the longevity of Italian in many areas of Italy are in a certain way linked, is in a certain way linked to the lifestyle, to the Mediterranean diet, to the fact that the red, white, and the green of the Italian flag, that means the tomato, the pasta, and the basils. So are some of the simple olive oil, some simple ingredients. But everybody was talking this without really knowing what really this meant at molecular level. So I started with the one of the most common, with the tomatoes. And when we tested, you know, the tomato was discovered in Peru, not in Italy, like many people. But an emperor in Peru as a gift gave to the south of Italy was dominated by the Borboni, okay, so Spanish and invasion. So donate to them these seeds. That these seeds that grew on the bottom of the Vesuvium, so having this particular environmental characteristic, they acquire a certain type of nutritional component. They made these tomatoes like San Marzano, like Corbarino, some of the most, let's put in this way, that the most used product in the gourmet business. So, and when we did this, blindly, happened that out of 50 extract of seeds of tomatoes that grew in that area, two of them, they have this nice characteristic that in a, an in vivo study, in in vitro study, in on cell line, in, they were able to protect the development or the onset of gastric cancer cell line. Of course, and then interestingly, when they were doing performing this action, somehow they were blocking the expression of the cell cycle gene. So basically having an effect on what is the really one of the key cellular mechanisms, the proliferation, the cell division cycle. So the retinoblastoma, RB-related, the cyclin A, CDK, that suggests basically that these the nutrients of this food that is everywhere on our table has some important characteristics. This should indicate to us something very simple, Ira, that does not mean that we can eat we could eat like pounds of tomatoes. But all this component of food in a correct diet and a healthy diet in which you can eat pasta, you can eat tomatoes, you can eat mozzarella, you can eat cheese, everything, all these things in the proper things, in the proper component and ratio of use, okay, can be at long run can be benefiting your life. And so environment, lifestyle together needs needs to find really a equilibrium in which we can care about our life. Then there is a speculation, everyone talks about everything, okay, so but you need to have also an explanation. Molecular biology and nutrigenomics, that is the field, could teach us really, it could give that information in which some of these proper food intake could help really the improvement of our and improve our quality of life.
Yeah, I think that nutrigenomics topic is so very important now, as you were pointing out with some of the devices and things like that, the wearables that we have nowadays, finally, I think can allow us to take advantage of what sort of the nutrigenomics vision has been the last few decades, but really exciting for 2021 and beyond.
Remember, we need to know, we need more and more to know the mechanism.
Exactly.
As I said many years ago when it was sequenced the entire genome, see, yes, we know the words, but in order to speak in a correct way, write in the correct way, sentence, we need to know the grammar. We need to know the sequence of events that can put together words in a correct way. And we are writing that sentence. They are writing that sentence. So that's one of them. And especially cancer, that is a multi-step process type of disease. You need everything. You need the mechanism, yes, but you need that people knows about the lifestyle. You need the environment, the impact of the environment. all these components together, the psychological component. Yep. In fact, a cancer patient now, they have the psycho-oncologist, they have the nutritional expert guy, they have the radiotherapist, they have the oncologist, they have a surgeon, they have pharmacologist, there is a team, is a multidisciplinary teams, because it's a disease that affects in a very complex way, all in a very heterogeneous way, all the different complex mechanisms and function in our bodies.
Very interesting time. Antonio, what could we expect from Sbarro Health Research Organization and Dr. Antonio Giordano in 2022 and beyond? What's hot? What's coming up? Conferences you're going to be at? New programs you're starting? Anything you can talk about further, please? I'll give you the floor.
My first important goal remains to train young, brilliant scientist, and to make sure that young scientists will more and more dedicate themselves to research. Mm-hmm. Because I am very much worried about the situation that many young people, prefer to go to pharmaceutical, they prefer to go to business because of the decrease in investment. This country is a leading country in the world in the discovery done in biomedicine. In order to do that, should not decrease, okay, mm-hmm. the funding opportunity that made United States number one in curing the disease. Even in the COVID battle, the technology in the United States and the minds that work around this were instrumental and were really important for creating vaccines, creating special drugs and knowledge in this field, more than any other country institution in the world. The Sbarro Health Research Organization wants to grow. It wants more and more that the world knows how silently, okay, made a major contribution in the field of human disease. We are a small organization. We are an organization that really now blossoming, okay, in a certain way due by the discovery that we made. And we work in conjunction with the university, but independently. So we are an independent organization. And while we continuous work in try to understand how to discover new methods for curing disease is happening. I really hope that the organization gets the recognition that deserves, independently by Antonio Giordano, because I would like the Sbarro Health Research Organization as to live beyond Antonio Giordano, but for really, the production that did in a very unique way and not following the mainstream, mm-hmm. okay, happens usually in this world, and I think that is my desire. My desire also finally is that in the mosaic that we are putting together, the complex mosaic that we are putting together, I would be happy in 20 years that one or two pieces were contributed by the scientists of the Sbarro Health Research Organization and by myself. That would be something that I really hope.
It's been a fascinating journey for you. I'm sure this will continue, and we're going to see a lot of fascinating things happening at the Institute over the next 20 years. But really, really fascinating story, Antonio, and really wishing you the best with all of this moving it forward. For everybody that's going to be listening to this particular episode of the show on our podcast or watching on the YouTube channel, you've been spending time with Dr. Antonio Giordano, President and founder of Sbarro Health Research Organization, professor of molecular biology at Temple University, professor of the Department of Pathology and Oncology, University of Siena, and director of the Sbarro Institute for Cancer Research, Molecular Medicine, and the Center for Biotechnology, all at Temple College of Science and Technology. Antonio, it's always great seeing you. I want to thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to come talk with us. Thanks for everything you've been doing there. And as we say on this show, thanks for helping to create a better tomorrow for all of us through your work. A really fascinating story.
Thank you, Ira. Thank you very much.